In this video, we'll be taking these and turning it into this, a dual Xeon 48 gig beast for under $700. Buckle up because it wasn't easy. Hint, because of these two guys. Now, I think the best place to start this story is with the purchase of my first HP Z800 server. Look at me here talking all proudly about my new purchase. Now, the seller did tell me that it wasn't working, and he cited power supply issues as the problem. And then with a quick Google of HP Z800 power supply issues, there seems to be a very common issue with capacitors going bad in these power supplies, and it seems to be fairly user serviceable. So I bought the PC, and when I actually got it, I opened up the power supply, and obviously I had no idea what was going on inside. There wasn't like an obviously burst capacitor or anything like that. So I decided, I'm quite embarrassed to admit this, but I actually called HP's customer service hotline and started asking the lady about how to actually diagnose a broken capacitor in one of these power supplies. Quite understandably, the lady was really confused as to why I was digging around the insides of one of their power supplies, and then she, in a very matter-of-fact tone of voice, said, "Well, how do you know the power supply is broken?" And she was right. Obviously, how did I know the power supply was broken? So I went through all of the steps of diagnosing what was wrong with the machine. And then I ended up realizing that the motherboard power supply cable wasn't making proper contact. And when I pulled it out a little bit, the PC actually switched on. So then I pushed it back in, hoping that it would continue to work because, you know, it would have proper contact now or whatever. And, well, it didn't. So when I started fishing around for that point where it switched on again, I accidentally set fire to a graphics card. Rest in peace, my good old friend. Sorry for destroying you in your prime. Really, catching on fire isn't the most ideal way to die. And at this point, I was actually worried that I had destroyed both of the Xeon X5675 CPUs as well, and all 48 gigs of RAM, but I decided to power ahead with my endeavor anyway. So then I started to look for a different solution. And weirdly enough, the easiest one was also the cheapest one. I found a website that sells refurbished old HP servers, and they begrudgingly sold me an HP Z800 server with no CPUs and no RAM in it, which is like the only components I really cared about the first PC. And they actually sold it to me for less money than just buying a HZ800 power supply off of eBay. And this actually brings me to the build portion of this video. And with that, it's time to actually see whether the conglomeration of the components between the two machines actually works. And now, first things first, we have to actually set the CPUs in the correct position. I love the fact that I have to say CPUs multiple and not just one. Very excited to see how this PC performs. The big issue with this motherboard is that it doesn't have the triangle in the corner of the socket to kind of help you determine which way around you need to put the CPU in. So you have to kind of match the pin array to the actual socket, which is obviously not ideal. Sorry, it looked like there were some bent pins in there. But no, I think they're all good. It goes in like... Don't worry, I'm gonna clean them a bit better before I put new thermal paste on. And there's no crunching sound when I close the actual CPU socket, so that's good. All the pins aren't being destroyed. So let me give them a good wipe down. It's the final wipe down. And then I'm gonna mount the actual coolers. Now, as far as CPU coolers go, I'm not gonna use the little dainty loser CPU coolers. I'm actually gonna replace them with these, two of them. This is the black edition of the Hyper 212. I've seen a video on YouTube of someone mounting them in this case, so that's why I actually chose them, because there's not much clearance. And according to the video, you can just screw the standoffs that comes with the cooler straight into the motherboard backplate so that you don't have to remove the motherboard from the case. Now, unfortunately, I've run into a little bit of a snag. So over here is the actual kind of standoff that you have to screw into the motherboard to be able to mount that Cooler Master cooler. And the actual hole for a standoff screw in the backplate is a tiny bit too small. I took the motherboard out because I thought that I could just remove the backplate and use my own backplate. But the backplate is actually a part of the socket, so there's no way to remove it. So I think I have two options at this point. One of them is I could just use the stock coolers on this and then be done with it. But that's really lame. So then I have a second option, which is to drill out the actual screw holes there. But that's terrifying. Taking a drill to a mounting hardware that's actually attached to a motherboard. Yeah, so I'm gonna see how that pans out. I'm gonna get a drill and I'm gonna kind of see how terrifying that's gonna be. Okay, so we're just gonna have to take a quick moment to appreciate the fact that I am a genius, because I figured out a way to mount it. Now, as you can see here, with the actual AMD mounting hardware, it uses these screws through the back of the actual backplate, which I'll illustrate with some B-roll. So then the screw comes up through the base so that you can attach these standoffs and then actually mount the cooler. Now that I've MacGyvered the CPU coolers onto the CPUs, it's time to actually see whether or not this PC works. Now, the last try that I had in the first configuration of the PC, the graphics card actually caught on fire, like I mentioned earlier. So I'm quite scared. I'm not going to put like a 1060, which I'm going to use eventually, into the PC on the first try because I don't want to destroy it. So over here, we have a sacrificial GPU. It's a GTX 285 and it's not worth much. So that's kind of why we're going to use that in the PC. If it catches on fire, it's not going to be a disaster. So let's put it in there and see how it goes. So now that I've effectively infuriated Anna, plugged everything in, including the sacrificial GPU, hopefully it works. I'm really hoping that everything doesn't catch on fire because I spent so much time on this already and I'm not even done with it yet. Okay, so Anna, you can kind of point at the PC. And then we're gonna see what happens. Oh, there's some cables in the fans. That's already a bad sign. I think it lives!
Why isn't the screen turning on?
Well, we've got that going. We've got this going. So the peripherals are lighting up. It hasn't beeped yet. Oh, the monitor might be off, actually. Oh, and it's on the it's on the wrong source as well. I'm just building tension here, guys. That's all I'm doing. And now there's no... Ooh! It lives! Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to install Windows on it and we're going to see how it works. So we know that it's not destroying graphics cards. So I'm going to plug the 1060 into it. And we're also going to paint the actual side panels because they're a bit scratched up. So we're going to sand it down and going to make sure that that looks all sexy like you saw in the intro. We have the two panels over there. I'm actually going to sand them first because they've got a bunch of scratches and stuff in them which I want to sand out, and then I'm going to paint it. Now, the reason that I'm not going to just sand them down and use the kind of like a brushed aluminium finish is because I've tried to hand sand a brushed aluminium finish into aluminium before and it wasted hours of my life and it still didn't work. So I'm not going to do that to myself. I'm just going to sand it and paint it. I'm actually going to film it through the window, so it's going to be pretty ghetto, but it's just going to be a quick time lapse anyway. Now, before we get any further into this video, I think it's an actual good time to mention the specs of this PC behind me here. Now, the CPUs are two Intel Xeon X5675 6-core CPUs with a base clock of 3.05 GHz. There's 48 gigs of RAM, which I don't think is ECC RAM. I've then got a GTX 1060 Palette Super Jetstream as a GPU in there. And for storage, I've got a 250 GB Samsung 860 Evo. The actual coolers that I'm using, like I mentioned at various points in this video, are Cooler Master Hyper 212 Black Edition Evos, which ended up not attaching nearly as easily as I thought they would. Now, when I actually finished mounting the coolers to the motherboard, I was really excited to put the motherboard back in the case. But unfortunately, because of the grooves in the back plate of the case, it actually wouldn't fit, so I had to cut the backs of two of those square pins off to have it actually slide in. And it is arguable whether or not it was worth it because this PC can't actually overclock, but they do run really hot with those stock loser coolers on, so it's still gonna make a difference. Now, first things first, the most exciting part, how does it do at Cinebench? And now with the Cinebench score out of the way, let's look at some gaming benchmarks. Now, before I get into the final productivity test that I did, let's just do a quick rundown of the benchmarks. And honestly, at 1080p, this PC performs really well, but a lot of that is down to the GTX 1060, and it doesn't seem like the CPUs bottleneck it too much. But one of the biggest issues with this system is the fact that it can't overclock, and that's what hurts its Cinebench performance, I think. Because at 3 GHz, each individual core just isn't fast enough. And if you take into consideration the fact that my AMD Ryzen 1700X CPU, when overclocked, can get 1,900 points in Cinebench, this PC just doesn't keep up. And honestly, you can buy a 1700X for not very much money, and it would also perform a bit better in gaming. Honestly, for 1080p 60 frame per second gaming, this thing is a beast, even with modern AAA titles. And I've been editing this video on it, and it performs pretty well. Not amazingly, but it performs decently. Now, a brief mention of one of the biggest issues for me when it comes to productivity with this PC is the fact that it doesn't have USB 3. So it means transferring files from an external hard drive or an SD card takes really long. Now, the final productivity benchmark I ran with this PC is Asus's Realbench, which is a really well-balanced productivity benchmark, and it got 121,991, which compared to the 145,428 of a PC that uses an AMD 2700X and a GTX 980 in it, isn't amazing. And here is the thermal performance of the two Cooler Master Hyper 212s on the Xeons. In conclusion, for $612, I think this PC is a pretty good purchase. And because you can get the gaming performance at 1080p that you can get from this thing, I kind of think it's worth it. And that brings me to the end of the video. Now, I have an Instagram and a Twitter account, so go and follow those if you want to. If you enjoyed this video, do like and subscribe to the channel for more videos like this one. And until the next one, bye-bye.